Hello YouTube, this is Adam again, and this is another video where I am going to try and fix some YouTube junk that I bought. So I just got this package in the mail today. It comes from Japan, and what's in here is going to be a Famicom. So if you're not sure what a Famicom is, it's understandable. You don't see them around too often in Canada or the US, but it's basically the Japanese version of that. Came out a couple years before the NES was released in North America. It plays slightly different cartridges. It's the same but different. So best thing I can really do, open it up and show you what I've got. So kind of interesting. The postage on this is comprised entirely of stamps. Never seen that before. I've never really ordered from Japan, but I don't know if that's normal or that's just how this particular person decided to package it up. So, first thing that I see, I mean, this just looks very small. I didn't really know what to expect, but compare it to an NES, which barely would even fit in this box. I mean, and we've got wrapping and everything here, and there we have it, a Famicom. So, take it out. It's almost half the size, maybe two-thirds the size of an NES. So very small for sure. Let's just get this out of the bubble wrap and see really what it is that we're looking at here. I unfortunately don't have any games for it yet, so I can't even test this. I have ordered some from eBay, just bought some cheap ones, but they just haven't arrived yet. I am expecting them fairly soon, though. Okay, so that's the Famicom. Overall, the physical condition of it looks fairly good. Has the controllers, which essentially the same design as the NES controller. The one specific thing between Famicom and NES that is different is controller number two. You notice that there's no start and select button, but there is a volume slider here. And what that is actually a microphone. It has a mic built right into the controller. And some games, such as Legend of Zelda, actually make use of that mic. I'm not sure the extent of it, but it does something to allow you to complete the gameplay. Another thing to note, these do not fit. You're not going to be able to use an NES game on a Famicom. So, unfortunately, there's nothing I can really do to test this to see if it works, but I thought it would be interesting to really take a look at this and see what it is we're working with. As you can see, the console itself is kind of yellow, so I might try and whiten it up a bit. There are a couple methods that you can do. They involve using a solution of hydrogen peroxide with some OxyClean and I think a thickening agent of some type, and you'd basically either submerge the entire plastic part in it, or you can rub it on kind of like a cream or gel. And then what that does, it reverses the yellowing effect from UV exposure. So once those games come in, I'm going to actually test this and see if it works, and if not, what it's going to take to get it to work. Hi YouTube, this is the next day and I actually just received the package of Famicom games I ordered. So finally I can give this guy a try and see if this is a working system or not. So I ordered, what happened is I ordered the console, I got it on eBay, it cost me about $25 American to purchase, including shipping to Canada. I needed some games in order to test it, so I bought some cheap games. They're nothing really, nothing special, but a couple of them are sports games like baseball. A couple of them are just inexpensive games that I found. Doughboy as an example. Golf. That one is baseball of some type. This is something, and something else. So I have no idea what the story with these games are, whether they work, whether the console works, whether they're good. I'm sure they're all crappy games, but whatever, that's not the point. So let's give this guy a try and see what we can do. So we'll look carefully at the back of the console, and there's a couple of inputs. There's the AC adapter, there's a switch for TV and game, and there's a switch for the RF adapter, which between channel 1 and channel 2. So in Japan, their TVs are tuned slightly differently than ours. Most RF adapters you find in North America, they make you go between channel 3 and channel 4. Well, in Japan, I guess obviously they do channel 1 and channel 2, but it doesn't work here in North America. So I have my CRT TV, and from what I've read, in order to get any type of signal, you need to tune it to channel 95 if you want to use the channel 1 input, or 96 to use channel 2. So let's hook this up. You also have to use a North American NES RF adapter. I guess the Japanese ones don't work, again, because maybe the frequencies are slightly different. I'm not sure the exact reason behind it, but the word is they don't work. Lastly, you're going to have to figure out the power adapter. This particular unit didn't come with power, and the size of the power adapter is actually the same as the North American NES, but you cannot use the North American NES adapter. That particular adapter, the way it works is it doesn't convert the AC power from your outlet into DC power that this requires. It keeps it in AC, and then it converts it inside the system. What that means is if you try and plug an AC power source into this and turn it on, you're going to fry something inside. So that's not an uncommon issue with Famicoms, is that someone tried plugging in a bad power source and killed it. Considering this came from Japan, that maybe won't be the case. This might work just fine, but we'll find out. Oddly enough, a good solution for this is Nintendo's rival, the Sega Genesis. If you have a Generation 1 Sega Genesis power adapter, so that's the bigger wide style, or Sega CD, it will work. So it outputs the proper amount of voltage, current, and it has the right polarity as well. It outputs DC power. So I'm going to plug that in. This is actually a kind of 2-in-1 multi-adapter, so it fits a Super Nintendo and a Generation 1 Sega or NES, and it will work for all of them. I'm just going to use this for testing, and then if it works, I'm going to source a dedicated power source. I don't really like using those 2-in-1s long term, but it'll work for the time being. So I think what we're going to try and get started with is the classic Doughboy. So this is the Famicom cartridge. Obviously quite a bit smaller than you might be used to with the Super, or with the regular Nintendo cartridges. I haven't really looked much at these, so I don't even know how to open these to clean them, but that will be something for another video if I can get any of this working. So I guess all we can really do is give it a try and see what happens here. So we'll plug in Doughboy. It feels pretty good as far as plugging it in. You might note that the Famicom has an eject button, so you hit that and it disconnects it. Not really necessary, but let's see. Alright, so power's hooked up, we're plugged into RF, turn the switch on, and what do you know? We have what seems to be a working Famicom system. So the controller seems rather touchy, but let's see what we've got. Okay, so select is to switch between 1 and 2 player, and now it's not doing anything. Oh, there we go. Well, it looks like this kind of works. So I think what I'll do is, we got some graphical glitching here. I don't know if that's just, we're having a hard time. So this controller might be no good. We may need to open the controller up to clean, but I am encouraged by the fact that I'm getting video, I'm getting audio. it seems to be generally working. So in a little bit, I'm going to open this up and kind of investigate a bit more. But for now, I'm going to test it with another game. So let's turn this off. Eject Doughboy. And let's... Oh, that wasn't Doughboy. That was something else. Let's go with Doughboy. I've heard of this game before, never played it. I don't know if they made a North American port for it or what their deal is, but let's see. I've heard really nothing but bad things about Doughboy, so let's see what we've got. I do like the cool thing about the Famicom is it seems to load these games instantly. There's no splash screen or anything else silly, so let's see. Alright, so looks like basically all you do is try and dodge stuff. Where am I? Oh. Evidently, I'm not very good at Doughboy. Oh, there I am. So I go down. I don't know what's going on, but... Oh, I think maybe it's just flaky with the pause. Well, either way, these controllers need a clean. The system needs a clean, so that'll be the next step here. So I'm gonna kind of get that started, and I will come back when we're ready to go. Okay, so I think we're gonna open up this Famicom and really kind of see what it looks like inside, give it a good thorough cleaning. I may even try and restore some of the original color. If you can see under these stickers here, that kind of cream color I think was the original color that it was rather than this more yellow color. So there's a way to go about reversing that yellowing that happens on some of the old Nintendos. So we'll go through that a little bit later in the video. Firstly, we're going to flip it over. So it looks like there's six case screws. And they just use a standard crosshead or Phillips screwdriver. So I'm going to take those off and I'll be back once it's... Okay, so the case screws are removed. One other thing that you might note is the controllers, they're hardwired into the system. So they can't unplug like they would on a regular Nintendo. As well, you notice that they're connected to the back of the system. So it seems like kind of a silly idea as it gets rid of a lot of... cord length that I have, so that's about, I don't know, 9 inches, 10 inches of cord that I'm not able to really take advantage of. Furthermore, these cords aren't very long, they're only about 3 feet long. In Japan, I mean, you don't get usually a whole lot of space in Japan with your homes, so that makes a bit more sense. Here in North America, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense. We have larger living rooms, more area to really make use of these, so seems just a little bit odd. I think the regular North American Nintendo controllers are 6 feet long, just to kind of give you a bit of a comparison. But anyway, so let's remove the top case. So it looks like the bottom just comes right off, and the board is actually fixed to the top half of the case. So you see the cords wasting even more space as they coil around to the front of the system and plug in right here. I don't know why they didn't just have them come out the front. Seems like that would be a smarter idea, but whatever. It is what it is. So it looks like there is 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, possibly this one here too, 6. 6 screws to remove in order to remove this board. So I'm going to get those out and I'll be back in a moment once that's... Okay, so those 6 screws are removed now and we're ready to detach the board from the main case of the console. So first thing I'm going to do is pop these out. That's the controller grommets, let's call them. Just so that I'm not breaking anything when I try to remove the board. So we'll let that sit off to the side. This one will come out and that one will sit off to the side. It is important to make sure when you reconnect it that the proper ones go in the proper spot. So, as I mentioned before, controller number 2, which is this one, has the volume switch on it and the microphone. Controller 1 has start and select. So controller one attaches to the left of the console, the right because we're looking at the bottom, and controller two attaches to the right of the console or the left looking from the bottom. So we will lift up the board here. That comes out rather easily. However, there is a, this is the power switch, so that has to be removed. The cord is soldered onto the board, so you have to be careful not to break that solder joint. This is the eject mechanism, and there's a spring holding that into place, so we will, for now, just push that off to the side and unscrew this button here that controls that power switch. So far, from what I've seen, all the screws seem to be interchangeable. This one here, again, is more of the same thing. So these are the screws, actually. No, it's the same. So these are the two different screws that came out of the inside of the case. And this is one of the screws that came out of the one that holds the case together. So they all appear to be the same. I'm going to keep them separated just in case, but just like the North American version of the Nintendo, I'm fairly sure that they can be used interchangeably. Okay, so we have the power switch off, and it's just a basic power switch. Looks an awful lot like the power switch used on the Super Nintendo. But yeah, so that's that. And here we have the top of the case. So this power button switch comes right off. Make a mental note that the red stripe on the power switch goes on the bottom of the case. And then the reset button, again, it doesn't appear to have any specific orientation, so that can probably go back in however you like. The last part will be this little spring here. So all I'm going to do is detach it from the bottom. I really don't want to break this spring, but it looks like it comes out fairly easily. I'm going to wash all the plastic parts here. I really don't want, like, this is pretty dirty. There's dust all over it. This is the eject mechanism. And then I got to get these parts here off, and I'm not sure how to go about doing that. I really don't want to break it. But I think the only way, there we go. Did I break it? Nope. It just doesn't have much to it. So there's a very small, see if I can focus a bit better here. There's a very small tip at the end of each one here. And I thought for a second I broke it because of how small it is, but that's just all there is to it. Presumably it's like that so that when you remove it or install it, you don't break it. Now, the last one I have to be careful about is this eject button. So it slides along these rails here. Supposedly these tabs are easy to break. Right there and there. I'm going to try carefully just to pinch in together here and lift. I really, really don't want to break this button. I almost have it. There we go. So that's the eject button, and it is not broken. So all of this is going to get a thorough wash. In some of my other videos, I've gone over how to wash consoles. I'll just describe it, but I'm not going to show you as it takes up a lot of time. But really, all I do is I set the sink full of hot water, use a bunch of dish soap, and let it soak for a bit. Let it soak and penetrate into all the dirt and grime. Wipe it off with a dishcloth. If there's any stubborn stuff that won't come out, specifically usually in these grills, or any of these corners, which the Famicom seems to have a lot of little edges and corners, then I'm going to use my toothbrush to get into there. So I'm going to let you guys go and get that cleaned up. And once it's back and ready to go, I'm going to show you how we tidy up the board a bit, clean the pin connectors, and reassemble it. Now, I almost forgot, I also want to clean these controllers, so I'm going to show quickly how to unscrew one of them and how to clean it up. So firstly, we have to detach them from the board. So it looks like these connectors just detach by giving a light pull, just like that, and same thing on the other one. So again, remember, this is the top of the board that you're looking at, Controller 2 will go in here. Controller 1 will go right there. So I'm going to move the board off to the side. Careful not to pull on this reset switch. Now, let's go with controller 1. So it looks that these are also Phillips screws. So just using my crossheader Phillips screwdriver, I should be able to unscrew all these. Yep. They are smaller, but my screwdriver here seems to work. The screws are different size from the cart or the console screws, so don't mix them up. It should be fairly obvious which ones are which. So I'll be back once this is. This is what we get with the casing unscrewed. So the back just pops right off, and what I'm going to do is take the wire out, and be careful not to give this too much of a pull. You don't want to detach the board from the rest of the from those contacts. So what you do when you clean this, I usually just use an alcohol swab and give these contacts a thorough cleaning. The most common culprit of bad controllers are these pads. So I'm going to take these off. I'm going to give them a bit of a clean and reinsert them, and we'll test to see if they work properly. So this is going to get soaked in hot water and soap, just like the rest of the console. And once they're dry, I'll show you how to reassemble. Now this is controller 2, and you might note that there's an extra part in here. Comparing it to the back of controller number 1, there's an extra chip as well. And that's presumably to control the microphone input. So again, being careful not to break any of the contacts. We lift that carefully up. I'm going to clean all of these contact points. And the case itself is going to go in the wash to soak, scrub, and hopefully clean out. This is the controller for the microphone, and that I'm going to clean separately. I don't want to get that wet. Okay, so the casing for the Famicom is now dry. As you may notice, it's still kind of yellow. It's tough to see on the camera, but it looks a lot more yellow for me in person. So what I'm going to do is try and clear that up a little bit. So I'm going to make this formula. Essentially what it is hydrogen peroxide, a little bit of thickener, and apparently adding glycerin helps to prevent it from really drying onto the console. If it dries on, that's where you can run into splotchiness, and I want to avoid that. So what I'm going to do is a good amount of hydrogen peroxide. This isn't medical grade peroxide. This is the stuff you get in the from a hair salon. So this is 30%. The average hydrogen peroxide you buy at a drugstore is about 3%. So I'm going to mix in a good amount of that. The formulas I've seen recommend xanthan gum, and I don't have any of that. I don't really want to go buy it, so I'm going to use cornstarch. Going to do the same thing, it'll thicken it right up, and then a little bit of glycerin as well will help to give it a fluid texture so that it doesn't dry. It'll turn into essentially a paste, because this comes in a liquid. This will thicken it up a bit, and this will keep it smooth. You're supposed to use also OxyClean. I don't have any of that, so I'm going to try it without the OxyClean first. If it's not going to work, then I'm going to go and get some OxyClean and try it again. You might notice the tape. The reason that's there is I put a layer of tape over top of the Famicom decal. Reason being, I don't know how the stuff's going to react with color, so I don't want it to ruin that decal. It would be difficult to replace. So I'm going to mix it up. I'll show you what it looks like, and I'll get it put on here. The other ingredient I forgot to mention is UV light. So, Mr. Turtle, I'm sorry, but I'm going to be borrowing your UV light for the night. I hope that's okay. Yeah, I'll come back once it's all ready to go. Okay, so this is what I've come up with. It's a little liquidier than I thought it would be, so if I'm having a hard time getting it on, I may resort to putting a bit more cornstarch in. But essentially, all you do from this point on is grab a paintbrush, an applicator of some type, take it, and you just start lathering it on. Get it into all the little nooks and crannies. So I'm going to start with this grill here, get it in those corners. You have to be very careful with this stuff, as it is corrosive. This stuff is used for preparing hair for dyeing, so it has to be very corrosive to really properly do what it needs to do. So get it on. I'd suggest using gloves or some other form of protection for when you have to go about moving this thing, because you're going to want to get it on all sides. And that may involve picking it up, moving it around a little bit. I don't actually have gloves here. I thought I did, but it turns out that I don't. So what I'm simply using is, when it comes time to pick it up, I'm going to use a plastic bag wrapped around my hand, pick it up like you're picking up a pile of dog droppings or something on the street. So I'm going to keep this going here. Just really lather it on everywhere. I'm debating whether I want to do the inside or not. I might. Probably can't hurt. But at the very least, you want to get it around all the different areas. So it turns out that I seem to have made quite a bit of this stuff. So I may do multiple applications of this. Make sure we're getting it in the cartridge slot here. Because when you open that cartridge flap, you will see yellowness if you don't get in there. And then get in the back of it here. So through all this stuff, I didn't cover these stickers. I think they'll be okay. But really, I guess we'll see what happens with it. Okay, so I'll get back in there. Make sure that that's all really well done. Now, for the record, this is the first time I've attempted this kind of thing, so I have no idea how this will really work out for me. It might ruin it, and I mean, I spent 10 bucks on this, so it's not the end of the world for me. That's why I'm kind of test driving it on this one. I don't want to destroy something that I've spent more money on this. Sorry, not 10 bucks, 30 bucks. So I don't want to really destroy anything that's worth money, so we'll try that first. What I'm going to do is cover that up with saran wrap or cling wrap or static wrap, whatever you call it where you're from, and I'm going to put the UV light on top of it. The thing that really triggers this reaction here to reverse the yellowing is the UV light, so that's extremely important. Normally, you could just leave it outside, but firstly, it's nighttime. And secondly, it is January in Canada, so it's about minus 12 Celsius right now. Alright, so I've got the solution in place on the Famicom, and I've got my two UV lights plugged in here. I'm going to let this sit for a while. I've also covered up the remainder so that hopefully I can still reuse it if I need to come back and reapply this. So I'm actually heading out right now. I'm going to be gone for about 2 hours. In 2 hours, I'm going to come and check on this. We'll see if there's any progress. We will reapply some, most likely, and also rotate the light so that it gets even coverage. You don't want shadows and all that to be showing up in the yellowness here. So that's all for now, and we'll see in a while and see what really happens of this. I'm very curious to see how this works. Alright, so here we are 2 hours later. Just going to check this out and see how it looks. So, at first glance, I really don't see much change. Like I mentioned, has only been 2 hours. I've heard of you having to leave this stuff out for like 6. And furthermore, this is just a UV lamp. Ideally, you let it out under the sun and let the UV from that really kick in. So it's not surprising that this isn't doing a whole lot. However, what I think I'm going to do is top up the hydrogen peroxide level on it, so just to give it a bit of a boost. So I'm going to grab the stuff that I already mixed up and let's just put some more in there. Give it a good amount so that it has the oxidizing for deoxidizing properties, whatever it is that makes it just work. And we'll try and mix that in. So again, being very careful not to actually touch this stuff, because if I rub it in my eyes or anything like that, it could cause me some severe discomfort. So mix that all up nice and well. I might put a little bit more cornstarch, kind of really let it thicken up a bit. So anyways, I'll mix that up and show you what I've got after that. Alright, so I've topped this up with the more potent mixture that I just whipped up. Ideally, my goal is to get the color of the plastic to match the color of this label. I think that's ideally what it's supposed to be like, and this label, which I assume is a transparent label, has blocked some of the UV from coloring that portion of the console. You can also see a little bit of the same thing at the front. There's a sticker right there. And the same deal, the color is quite a bit different. I wonder if it's possible to see the color difference on the front versus the sides. Not really. So, I really don't think much has come of this. So, what I'm going to do is let this go all night now. I'm going to put the UV lamp back on it. I'll check on it in the morning. Tomorrow morning, if I'm not seeing much progress, I'm going to make a new batch of that. And I'm going to leave it outside for 4 hours. So I'm going to go to work, come back, check on it at lunch, see what the progress is going to look like. So yeah, I'll see everyone in the morning and we'll see what has come from this. Okay, so we're back. It's the morning and let's see what we have here. Let's turn those off. It's really hard to say. It doesn't look a whole lot different. Maybe slightly whiter, but not a lot. So when I was doing a little bit more research on this, I've seen that people with their black lights, UV lights, the light was more of a kind of blue, black, purple light. So my guess is these lights that I have here, they're UV lights for pets, like reptiles, and I think they only cover part of the UV spectrum. So that may be why we're really not getting any progress here. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to clean this up a bit, reapply the solution, and we'll just put it outside in the sun. It is very cold today, it's about minus 19 degrees Celsius, so hopefully this stuff doesn't freeze. I don't imagine it will, but I guess we'll find out. So I'm going to let you go and I'll show you what we've got in a bit. Okay, so I have topped it up and it's outside here. Sun is just starting to come up. Hasn't quite poked over the houses yet, but you should get partial sun during the morning here. And I'll be back around lunch to check on it, see if there's any difference. So hopefully this makes a bit more of an impact. Okay, so it's been out in the sun now with the solution on for about 4 hours, and it's hard to tell really what the difference is. I'm going to turn off these fluorescent lights. It's hard to say. The one thing that I am trying to look for is really the difference in the color of the sticker. So that looks more consistent, so I mean, maybe it is starting to whiten up a bit here, hopefully. Either way, what I've done, I've reapplied some of that solution, and in this case, I've just put pure peroxide on it. Give it the full strength, let it really try and straighten up a bit, or lighten up a bit, and see what happens for the rest of the day. So, it's about 1 o'clock right now, and it was left outside at 8:45, so been out there for a bit over 4 hours, and this is the result so far. So I'm going to leave it outside again. I was concerned that this stuff would freeze, but that doesn't seem to be the case. It's just it's too potent of stuff to really freeze. And it's not warm out. It's about minus 15 or minus 20 Celsius. So we'll put it back outside, let it go for the rest of the day. When I'm off today at about 5:30, we'll come check on it and see what we've got. Okay, so it is now about 5:40 p.m. and this has been outside since 1 o'clock. So we've got 4.5 more hours out in the sun. And I mean, it's hard to say, but I think it does look a little bit better, whiter. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to wash off all the hydrogen peroxide solution, and we'll see once it's sitting there clean how it actually looks. So I'm going to do that, and I'll be back in a few. Okay, so I've rinsed it all off. I've washed the solution off in the sink. Really, all it took was just some hot water. It seems to come off pretty well. And this is what I'm left with. So I do think that it has improved. Again, it's difficult to really tell on this phone, but I think it looks a lot better. And when you flip it over, you can kind of see it's a little bit more yellowed. Again, it doesn't really show up the best on the phone, but let's see if I turn off the light, if that makes a difference. And inside the slot also looks pretty good. So, I mean, I think that's a lot better. Once I put it, I'll just kind of set it on the bottom here just to get an idea of how that will look kind of assembled. So there we go. I mean, that's not too bad. I think it could be a bit lighter, so I'm going to repeat this again tomorrow. I'm going to have it out in the morning, and I'm going to leave it out there all day again, see if we can't make that a bit lighter still. Nice and bright and looking good. So definitely the solution was outside in the sun. UV lights, whether mine just weren't good enough, they just don't seem to do the trick. Sunshine, even in the middle of January, still is a whole lot more powerful. So I'll show you the results tomorrow once I've put another day into this, and we'll see if it's ready to be reassembled by then. So while the case is outside getting a little bit whiter, we're going to look at the board right now. So the board itself, excuse me, it works fine, but as you can see, it's just loaded with dust. So I'm going to blow some of that dust off, and then what I'm going to do is take a quick look at it, look for any type of liquid or drink that may have been spilled on it, try and clean that up, and then clean up the cart port, or the cart slot, sorry. There's lots of videos on how to do that, but generally what I use is a toothbrush, some rubbing alcohol, get in those pins, scrub them nice and well. If it's anything that really won't come out, I use some super fine grit sandpaper, wrap it around a card like this, and then just go in the slot to try and get the stuff actually out. I'm not going to bother disassembling this, as we do get audio and the power works fine, so really I'm just going to give this a quick clean up, and I'll be back in a minute when that's done. All right, so the board's nice and cleaned up here. So I got onto the actual board itself with the toothbrush, got all the dust and crap out. Underneath the pin connectors was a tricky spot to get into, as these pin connectors don't come out. So you gotta get in there with a toothbrush, try and get as much out as you can. The actual pin connector inside looks good. The pins didn't really come out too dirty or anything. I also just kind of used a little bit of sandpaper to buff up the top of this RF shielding on the RF modulator. So just use the 1500 grit sandpaper, put a little bit of alcohol on top first, rub it around, wipe it up with a Q-tip. So this is all the dirt and grime and dust and rust that came off of this unit itself. So it looks a lot better. Also, don't forget to get in here. Because it is a whiter plastic, it's prone to staining and like scratches and leaving marks in there, so you're never going to get it perfectly clean, but give it a bit of a touch up so that it looks a little bit better. But otherwise, this board is good and it's ready to go. All we're waiting now for is the top half of the casing to stay outside for a day and get a little bit de-yellowed, and we'll see what that looks like tomorrow. All right, so another day out in the sun, and I just uncovered it, and this is what we've got here. So with the white solution on it, it still does look kind of yellow. What I'm going to do is clean this up, and we'll see how it really looks just by itself. Hopefully it's made some improvements over yesterday. So this is after the second full day in the sun, and I really do think it looks much lighter now. Couple cues to look at are these decals here. If you remember earlier, the sticker was considerably lighter than the rest of the console, so it's balanced out quite a bit. Same with this decal here. It was also much lighter than the rest of it. Another telling fact is when I flip it over, I did not do the treatment to the inside, and it is still a fair bit yellower. I think this did lighten up a bit, as I did have it seep through and some reflected off the snow, but otherwise, this seems to do the trick. I have to decide if I want to do it again tomorrow to really lighten it up or not, but if so, I will show you what I've got. If not, I'm going to let this dry and then I'll be back when we're ready to reassemble. Okay, so I have lightened up the top color here, so it's significantly whiter than it was when I originally got this. I did not do the inside of the cover, so when I flip it over, it took a bit of the whitening, but it is a bit more yellow still, and it's tough to pick up on my camera, especially as I have LED and fluorescent bulbs here, but it is fairly noticeable in person. So what we're going to do now is get started on reassembly here. So I guess we'll just kind of go in reverse order of what I did initially. So first thing I'll start with is the power switch, and I am about 90% sure that the slanted side with the lip here went on the front. So all it does is you pinch in the corners and it snaps into place just like that. I'm pretty sure that's what we have to do. And then we have the actual game release mechanism. So that sits, the little metal part that sticks up right here goes inside this slider, and it sits just like that, and it'll move along like this. And then the spring gets wrapped around this post right down here at the bottom right there. So you try and work it around, and there we go. So now, when I slide it up, it will automatically come back down. Okay, so that's that. Power switches. So the power switch goes on the right side looking from the bottom. And as we remember, the little red stripe on the bottom stays on the bottom. So that way, when you turn the power on, it shows the red. When it's off, it's just burgundy or maroon or whatever you call this color. Lastly, we have the reset button, which I believe just sits in any orientation. I don't think it really matters. Okay, so that is that. Now we have the circuit board. So it's going to fit in just like that, and we have to screw in the power switch. We also have to reconnect the controllers. So you pay careful attention to which controller goes in which port. Controller 1 and controller 2 is the one with the volume switch here. So controller 1 is going to connect on the bottom on the left side, just like this, I think. Maybe the other way. Okay, so if you look carefully, let's try and get a better focus. Did we get anything? So you see on one side there's a little notch on the top right there, and the other side there is not. So that notch is going to face down when you plug it in. So you flip it over so the notch is down, and then you plug it in. Same thing with controller number 2. So we look for the notch, face it down, and then plug it in. So next what we will do is get it flipped over here. The trouble again is being careful to make sure that you're not disconnecting this at all, as it doesn't disconnect easily. It's soldered onto the board. So flip it over, keep the board nearby, and you line up the switch in the little the button on the top. There's two posts that will go through the pole here, and it just simply screws into place. So these use those Phillips screws, and again, they are the same between all the internal and the case screws, so it really doesn't matter which ones you actually use. And screw number two. And you may have to gently push this eject mechanism out of the way, but it's fairly easy to get this in. Okay, so that's in place. So the circuit board is going to simply just sit like that, and lining up the reset button and making sure that these are out of the way. However, you do have the power cords to contend with. So the way these work is they wrap around, they go up through here, they wrap around this post just to make sure that you're not, if you tug on the controller cords, it's not ripping them off the board, and then it goes out the back. There's also these little grommets that you have to make sure that you put around. I don't think it matters which way they go, so I just snap it on and then slide it in place. And same thing for the next one. So we have to lift the board up because the controller cable has to go under this expansion port. Then it goes through this guide, loop it around the post, and out the back. And once again, make sure that you attach the second grommet. And there we go. So that's loosely in place. We still have to screw it all in. So there were six screws that hold the board into place. And you just go through the whole thing and screw them in. I'm not going to record this all. I'll come back once it's... Okay, so I've got the screws in place. And there is one thing that I noticed. It appears that there's actually eight screw holes in here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Now, I only have six screws, and I had to go replay some of the previous video that I took to verify that there were ever only six screws in here. So I'm not sure if that means somebody took a pair of screws out and lost them or whatever, but these ones right here currently do not have screws in them. I decided that to make sure that I put them on the back here, as that's where you're making all the connections. That's where most of the force on the board is going to be. So it's important that these are fixed in place. These ones, I mean, it is good to have them in there, but something that I can let go. These ones you need to have in because that's what hold the cartridge slot in place. And, I mean, I guess these could... Well, you have the expansion port here, so these really aren't expendable. So we're going to put the back or the bottom on now. So, again, it's simply six screws. It fits in place like this. And the thing you got to do is just make sure that it's sitting flush, that these controller cords aren't getting in the way of anything. And again, six screws in place. I'll come back once those are in. All right, and the screws are now in. So the last part remaining is this cart slot cover. So it just fits in here. What I try and do is bend it slightly and it just goes right in place. So just like that. It's not spring loaded or anything, so you don't have to worry about getting that in. And then the little cover for the expansion slot. Sometimes when you buy these online, this will be missing. And I mean, it's not the end of the world, but it's nice that that's there and it just sits in place like that. So this is all ready to go. I'm gonna hook it up and we'll give it a test just to make sure that everything's working properly. Okay, so I've gotten this hooked up, and I mean, after looking at it a while, having it in place on top of this NES, I think it really does look a lot better. It looks a lot whiter. It was pretty yellow when I got it. It wasn't too bad, but this just looks so much better. So I've got it hooked up. Again, very important reminder, never, ever, ever use an NES power cord on a Famicom. You will blow something on the inside. Hopefully it's just a capacitor and a voltage regulator, but unless you want to do some repairs and you're handy with a soldering iron, just buy either a Sega Genesis adapter or one of these multi-adapters here. I bought this at a pawn shop for 10 bucks, and it does a Super Nintendo, NES, Generation 1 Sega, Sega CD. It outputs a correct voltage and amperage for the Famicom, and it does work with the NES. However, you can't use the NES adapter with this. So, something to keep in mind. So we've got this hooked up. We'll hit the power switch, and looks like we're in action. So, I keep forgetting how short these cords are. Like I said, I'm sitting, these are my feet right here, and the controller only comes up to here. So it is very, very short. So let's get some Doughboy going. Select. Okay, so select is to, let's do two player, just to make sure both controllers work. So it seems to be good. We're not having any of the case where it would be pausing itself. Let's make sure that A works. Oh, just died. Where am I here? So B. Sorry. I'm trying to get this lined up so that. Okay, so B is to shoot, I think. Well, A is to shoot. So you have to aim and then shoot. Okay, let's try controller 2 now.